Hey, look, loom bands are useful for something. Hi there, and welcome to Jokut's Workbench. Soon, I am giving a hands-on course about soldering and tinkering for some kids. I want them to have something to play around with at the end, that is easy to understand, and that has all moving parts visible. And so, I designed little two-wheeled vehicles that can follow a black line. They run on two AA batteries and have 3D printed drive units that use belts and pulleys to drive the wheels. Engineering these units was quite a bit of work, and I ran into a challenge that I didn't expect to exist. Welcome to a deep dive into toy DC electric motors. This little electric DC motor is commonly found in battery-powered toys. The exact design has not changed since, well, electric toys, basically. At least not since my childhood. Everyone who is watching the great channel of Randy Rain will know what I mean. I wanted to use two of these motors in my vehicles. I had one lying around, which I took from one of our kids' toys some years ago. That toy uses a motor to rotate the pond, and it used to be annoyingly loud. To make it less loud, back at the time, I replaced the motor with a much quieter one. I started with laying out the schematics on a breadboard. The motor is driven by a large transistor, which is driven by a small transistor, which is driven by a phototransistor. Something white in front of that transistor reflects back light from an LED and makes the motor turn. The result was promising, and now I needed more motors. I went into a cheapo store and got some of these little battery-powered fans to salvage the motors. To my surprise, in my setup, these motors hardly turned, and when they turned, they had no power at all. And so, I ordered motors from a robotic toy parts website, and they did not work either in my setup. What on earth? Time for some measurements. Here is one of the fan motors. At 2 volts, it takes almost 450 milliamps just idling, and when I stall it, the current goes up to nearly 2 amps. Ouch! I made a primitive motor torque comparison rig. It has this location here where I can clamp down a motor, and it has a lever with a piece of rubber at the end that rests on the motor axle. The axle rubs against the rubber and the friction slows it down. I can shift a weight back and forth on the lever to decrease and increase the load, and find the spot where the motor stalls. My tool measures the torque in, let's call it centi-cows. I know, this is an awful and unprecise way to measure torque, but at least it creates some numbers that I can compare. I do all tests at 2 volts. And you can see the current that goes through the motor on my bench power supply unit in the back. Here is my original toy motor. It uses 140 milliamps idling. I need to shift the weight on my rig all the way to the right to stall it. Then it takes 1 amp. In comparison, here is one of the fan motors. It needs 450 milliamps while idle and stalls at a much smaller load while drawing a whopping 2 amps. The motors that I ordered online were similar. They also had a low amount of torque, took about a half amp just idling, and also used way too much current when stalled. Let's take them apart and see what the difference is. Here are the three motor armatures. My first surprise came when I saw how short these armatures were. All motors that I took apart as a kid had longer armatures, more like these here. The shorter armatures must be something more recent, a cost-cutting measure maybe. The shorter stack of metal plates definitely means that the magnetic field is weaker, and these motors are less efficient than the old ones. I also noticed the very low number of copper windings on these armatures. They explain the low torque of these motors, the high stall current and the high idle RPM. The idle RPM of a DC motor is limited by the so-called back EMF, back electromagnetic force. When the motor runs, it always acts as generator too. The induced current is backwards and effectively increases the winding resistance and reduces the forward current through the motor. Armatures with more turns have a higher back EMF and hence a lower idle RPM. They also have more torque and overall a better efficiency. These motors here are very inefficient, but in many toys that does not matter. The motor is often hooked up directly to the battery and nobody cares how long that battery lasts. The gear train often starts with a warm drive to gear down the high RPM. That is also why such toys are often ear-strainingly loud. The motor characteristics explain why my circuitry here did not work. The transistor that I use creates too much voltage drop at the high current that these motors need to start, especially under load. I tried driving one of my wheel assemblies from the fan motor and it took 650 milliamps. Using two of these motors in my vehicle would have meant nearly 1.5 amps of current, which would have drained the AA batteries quite quickly, and the voltage drop would have made the LEDs too dark to activate the phototransistors. So using these motors was simply not an option, but I already had them and so I decided to improve them by adding more windings. I made a winding rig that allowed me to clamp the armature to a small rotor that has a crank on the other side. I emptied one of the armatures. Then I soldered on my new wire and started cranking. I rewound each side and ended up with an armature that has 3 times 150 windings. At 2 volts, that modified motor was idling much slower, but it took only 100 milliamps. It also had much more torque and even when stalled, it took only about 500 milliamps. When driving one of my wheels, it took only 180 milliamps at 2 volts. The unmodified motor took 650 milliamps at 1.1 volts or 0.7 watts. The modified motor needs more voltage to get to the same speed, but it has only 0.36 watts of power consumption, which is about half of what the other motor has. That was exactly what I needed for my vehicles, and after winding more motors, I could finally finish the design. My vehicle design is optimized for being easy to build and easy to understand. The functioning of the drivetrain is essentially self-explanatory. The belts are loom bands. The two belt transmissions create a combined gear ratio of 1 to 20, and the cog and gear assembly for the wheel a ratio of 1 to 4, for a total ratio of 1 to 80. The plastic parts of the transmission can be 3D printed relatively quickly, and the other parts that are needed are commonly available. The electronics side of things is simple too, and the soldering can be done by a beginner. Each motor has its own driver circuit. The phototransistor picks up light from a neighboring LED that is reflected back from a white surface. A black surface reflects less light, and when one of the sensors goes over the line, that side slows down and the vehicle moves back into a position where the line is in the middle between the sensors. As somebody who owned a thermal receipt printer, creating enough black line was easy too, and the vehicles can follow it surprisingly reliable, as long as the bends in the line are not too sharp. The 3D model is made in FreeCAD and you can download it on printables.com. The schematics and building instructions are on my Hackaday profile, for the case you want to build your own vehicle. Just make sure you get motors that don't suck as much as mine did. I had a lot of fun designing these vehicles and in the meantime I gave the course. That was fun too. And I might make more vehicles when I find more curious people for a maker's course. That is all for this time. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe. And see you next time.